I don't know, you're digging. As long as you guys are with me, I'm with you. Alright, so we are below the middle of this section that begins on page Pesayin. And the line starts with the Roshetevus Va'al Kain. Vav Ayin Chof.
Check on that table.
Oh, that table?
I was getting set up. We starting at what line now?
The line starts with Al-Kain, Atzilus, just below the middle of the page. And the principle that we're discussing now is that lemailo, mailo umato, upper and lower, are not the result or more or less than of oir, which would appear, so to speak, from a worldly perspective. More oir is lemailo, and less oir is lemato. However, that is not the defining factor. The defining factor is what's called an etzem, an essential distinction, difference. And this etzem principle does not have a worldly definition. Etzem is defined by that which is higher than world, by the Creator. We discussed this the first several days. And having discussed this in spheres, and let me discuss it now in worlds, says on the world distinction level, so to speak, Atzilus and Bria and so forth, Atzilus is has an inkling. There is a sense of what etzem is, but not etzem ho'er, but etzem haziv, as we discussed. The whole principle of recognizing etzem has to be is due to the fact that there is a relationship to the atzmus itself, above world. World, everything in world is a developmental process. It's a cause and effect. Everything in the world has a reason. That which is beyond reason is not world. And therefore, now we're going to start this line, the alchemy. And thus, Alkin, therefore comes after having said that this which is above Atzilus is not in world, the above world. Alkin, and therefore, Atzilus who has cholas on Gilui. Atzilus is the starting point of the Gilui of revelation. Avo mashal ma'alam Atzilus, but that which is above Atzilus, shezehu b'chinas ha'atzmus, which is the aspect of the Atzmus, Areze Bukinas Helem. That is in a state of Helem. Helem means it's concealed. Which means not because it's being hidden, but because it's something that you have no access to, you have no way of grasping it. I always like that we should have a feel that we are, you know, what is this about? The one way to remind ourselves of what we are talking about and how we have Helam and Etzem and Gili and so forth, is by remembering the words of the Rambam. That the first principle is that there is a first being, and we discussed it many times. First being is not something that we can comprehend. We have no way of defining what does it mean that first came here. Where does it come from? Why is it there? And yet, he is the first being. He is the starting point of everything. Pardon me, but I don't want to go to the way. This is an extremely important principle. Again, very difficult for us to really relate to. We can think of it, understand it, but first being, the statement that there's a first being states the following. We have a world. And in the world we have all kinds of different things. And everything that we observe has a definition, as a source, as a reason. The sun, the moon, the stars, the oceans, the seas, everything has a beginning, has a functional defining element. Then there is the whole principle, there is an existence. What is that about? The neutral existence itself, where does that come from? Does that come from someplace, or is this something which does not have a source? And this is where we differ on the principle between the worldview and the theory. And the Torah view. And the Neshama view. This is just an everything, even the very fact that there is a space, as the Gemara says, means even in the emptiness of the world, in the space of the world. You think this is the beginning of all everything? This is a created entity. The Gemara says, this, I'm going into this because I know how difficult it is to orient ourselves in this arena. Who mekoy meshaloylo vein hoylo mekoy me? Who he, Hashem, is mekoy meshaloylo, he is the one who provides place for the world. Vein hoylo mekoy me, the world does not provide place for him. He precedes Homitzius of mekoy meshaloylo. He creates Mekoy Meshaloylo. Therefore, now once we have mentioned that, we can understand that aspect, that which creates Mekoy Meshaloylo, we have absolutely no access of understanding it, of knowing it. This is what we're saying over here. The outing, and therefore Atzilus, as far as Agili. Atzilus is the beginning of Gili, of revelation. Of something that is expressed to be known. Avo mashal ma'alu atzilus, but that which is above atzilus, shezeh bechinas ho atzmus, which is the bechina of atzmus. Again, I'd like to call your attention to the expression over here, bechinas ho atzmus, rather than ho atzmus, because atzmus. Many are madrigas between Atzilus and Atzmus. But above Atzilus is Bechinas of Atzmus. We discussed many times Bechinas of Atzmus means the aspect of Atzmus. It is still an Atzmus element. It is not a worldly element, it is Atzmus, an Atzmus element.
want to go back there, a minute or two. The Gemara quote, you said that Hashem provides a place for the world, but the world doesn't provide a place for him.
But
the second part of the quote, isn't it about Emuna? Aren't we providing a place for Hashem with Emuna, with our Emuna?
Think about this. Think about the heart. If you're the one who provides a place for Hashem,
it's not equal. I know it's totally.
No. Just think about it. Not equal. What kind of a moon is this? That the moon is creating Hashem in your mind.
It's creating.
Creating Hashem. Yeah. Is that Hashem? No. It's your own creation. A moon means connecting to Hashem, not by your words, by your definition. But find out that you know it is there. That's not even a moon. Again, the Alkane Atzilus Haskalos Agil. Alkane, therefore, Atzilus is the beginning of Gil. Kili means that which becomes known, so to speak, within the worldly arena, worldly scheme. Even though Atzilus is a super world, but nonetheless it has a worldly structure. It's Chochmah Bina Da'at, there is Sfiras and Eretz Yekidah. Ava Mash and Ma'amei Atzilus, but that is above Yitzchak. Shezehu Bechinas O'atmos, we stopped at the word Bechinas O'atmos, which we discussed many, many times. I'd like you to think into it to the extent that it's possible. This is not the Atzmus, this is the Bechinas. This is in the realm of Atzmus. Meaning it's not, this has not had the quality of being a created entity. Hareze Bechinas Hel. That is Bechinas Hel. Which means not that it hides itself. It is Hel. If you would be put into it, you wouldn't know what you're looking at. Bechinas Hel. Okay. V'chein, similarly, b'hamadregei sholamayla me'atzilus guf, within the madregeis that are above Atzilus, there in that arena itself, gufa, in that arena itself, as we said, this is b'chinas o'atzus, but there are many madregeis within that general realm. So he says, Madriga Shulamal Matis Gufat Bechinas Ak moved al Bierach me Madriga Shulamatim men. That the Bechina of Ak is moved al Bierach is beyond in proximity from Madriga that are below it. Shahare Nikro Odom Kadmoy. Since that Ak, the word Ak is a Rosh Tavis, Odom Kadmoy. It is called Odom Kadmi. Odom refers to a seder, an order of koyfis, starting from Chochmah on down. This is Odom. Chochmah Bina V'Da'as. Odom Kadmi. The word Kadmoin is, the word Kadmoin, the only way to translate it is pristine, before existence. Thank you. Thank you. Kadmoin means not a first as a second. Kadmon means that which before existence, preceded existence. That's meant Kadmon. This Adam Kadmain. This means that this is the Adam that precedes existence altogether. The Pirush Adam Kadmain. What does it mean, Adam Kadmain? The pristine Adam. Now, an Adam before Adam was created. So, what kind of Adam is this? Who, the Pirush of Akub, Adam Kadmain, is Shezehu Bechinas Adam. This is that aspect of Adam, Sha'ala B'makshava, that all actually entered in thought, B'Oyer and Soif, Kadmel Chagdum, in Oyer and Soif, Kadmel Chagdum, which precedes anything that precedes it. The B'Tzalam Alakim also is Adam, as we know from the Pasuk. That Adam was made B'Tzalam Elokim in the form of Elokim. Ukshem Shehu Kodum. Just as he, Elokim, is Kodum, precedes everything. Elokim did not come into being. Like you say from the Rambam, Motzu Yerishim. Just as he is Kodum, Kach, the machshavte kedumo. That right, thusly, machshavte, his thought, and that which is contained in his thought is also kedumo. Is also pristine. In other words, there is nothing that arouses that thought. Again, I try very much to get our thinking into that arena. The reason that we can even begin to think in terms of karma within our world and our experience, we do not encounter anything of this nature. And there's absolutely no way for us to know it from our experience. Absolutely none. So what are we talking about, and how do we talk about it, and what is it referring to? What is it addressing? And the Rebbe is explaining this. Who does he address this to? He addresses this to us, and who are we? We are the Rebbe's creation. We have a godly soul. The godly soul, this is too literally a godly status, level. And from here, allow this godly soul to give us some illumination, we'll be able to understand, to relate to things that are on the godly level, that do not need to be created. This is the Kadmon element. And that's what the Rebbe is explaining. That Adam was created B'Tzelem Elokim in the divine form. And what does that mean? Normally we say B'Tzelem Elokim, this is the structure of Chochmah, Bina, Das and so forth. But there is a deeper inference there. Tzelem Elokim means Shem Shehu Kodum, just as he Hashem Elokim is Kodum. Kodum means he precedes all existence. He does not come into existence. He is there before being there, so to speak. Means Kodum. just as he is kodom, everything about machshavte, his thought is also ketuba. How does human thought, does human thought develop? Something has to arouse that thought. Something has to prick it. What made you think of this? But then there is an element of machshava that about the neighbors that does not have any pricker that arouses machshava. His thought is a direct flow from his own from him. Machshava k'duma.
It's strange that we thought seems to have a subject. Thought seems to have a subject and deals with definition. So pristine thought is seemingly a contradiction, right?
Yeah. So as you said, this is like a contradiction. Nonetheless, I would like that we should have a sense of the significance of this. We've discussed it many times, but sometimes you're learning something and you have a difficulty to relate, like you said, it's a contradiction, I don't understand what this is about. And then as you learn it and you're being explained, so forth, oh yeah, of course, I always knew that. If you always knew that, why would you have such difficulty in relating to it? Yes, it is. This is knowledge at a superconscious level. It's not knowledge that came to you. It is knowledge that's pristine knowledge within the human being.
Right. And at that level, it seems more like a vision than a thought. An insight, we'd say.
Well, insight, but it also has an element of thought, because ultimately he can translate in an action. This is the right way to do it, I don't know why.
That would be an example where the insight.
Why does your being stand on 2 feet?
What?
What is your being stand on 2 feet? Why doesn't he crawl on 4? It's much more secure. And you have this little baby standing up and falling down, standing up. Well, he insists on standing up.
Wait, here we're just pointing out that this action is based on a insight that sort of precedes thought, came through thought, became
action. This is
action,
thought. No, this
right?
is thought. This is thought. This is thought. Otherwise, you wouldn't know how to stand up.
Okay.
But it's thought on a pristine level.
Okay.
Not thought that a thought that developed, thought that is inherent in his makeup. I'm sorry, this is where the Rebbe is taking us, and my job is to try to explain what the Rebbe is explaining. If this is too far, tell me and we'll change our topic.
It's not far enough.
Not far enough.
Good answer.
Once you get there, once you have some inkling that you can't let go, right? So that's what we do. Ukmei shekosu b'mokim acher, as it's explained elsewhere, and the reason Rebbe says "Mishkosu b'makim acher" is both to give you, tell you that there are other places, try to find them, but to know, you should know that what I gave you that now is mamish it's not even surface. It's not even discussed sufficiently over here. The ayin mashikosha bidruj gimel min yod. So it's explained in that drush, in that maimer, gimel min yod, three madrigas in order. The ark, so he says, whether the ark that Odom Kadmon hook may Odom Horish. Odom Kadmon, in our, at our level, we would think of it like Odom Horish, not the first man. What's unique about Odom Horish? Think about this. Shehoyo Yitzir Kabbal Shalkodesh Bor. He was he formed and created. By the hands of HaKadosh Baruch Hu himself. So when you meet up with Odom Horish, you ask him, where do you come from? I'm just here. I don't come from any place. Is he a Kabbalah of HaKadosh Baruch Hu? Moi Cain, likewise, Be'ak Odom Kadmon, Hakeilim Hein, Me'ein Yisoyv Baru. The Keilim world, basically, is the principle of world. It begins by recognizing that there is Keilim, not only Oyer, but Keilim. Kelim means a means of representing something. So the Kelim in Ak, Hei, Mei, Nesod, Baru. The Kelim themselves are rooted and coming from Oyer and Soif. The Kelim are also Oyer, and not only Soif, but Oyer and Soif. Shalei, Aldei, Amtos, Eze, Madriges. Without any intermediacy of any other Madriges. The Kelim themselves are rooted and come from Oyer Sof. The Imkain, and therefore, Mugon, it is self-evident. The Gam Hoyer, the Ag, if the Kelim are of Oyer Sof. Therefore, it should be understood that the Oyravak Hulamailo Harbe Be'etzem Adrigosi is much above Be'etzem Adrigosi in an essential manner. Legabe Ho'eira Shulamatim relative to the Oyras that are below it. I'm going to finish it in whatever discussion we have. I don't have time. Maybe another day. V'yesh leimah shezeh gamkin, what's called Atzmus v'haor. Okay, the following, this is just going through it. This is the union of Atzmus and Ha'ora. Atzmus means the Atzim, the essence. Ha'ora means that which is only a reflection. She'arei kol ha'gilulim to miyak nikroim ha'volim be'ak. All gilulim, all that emanates from Ak is called ha'volim. That means hevel. Hevel means hevel ha'volim. That means it's a presence, but it's an empty presence. Gam ha'amshocha b'mchinas achap, what's achap? Achap is eizen chaytem peh, the topmost kelim, koiches by a human being, is the ear, the nose, and the mouth. Nikra hevel, that also is called hevel. Shezel b'chinas ha'or olavat. which is the Bechina of Ha'ara, just the Bechina of Ha'ara. Okay. This is clearly in extreme brevity. It's not meant to be presented to a point where it can be understood. The point of this is to bring out a means of defining things which are not definable, things which are distinguished, what's called on an essential level rather than a functional level. And we, in our discussions, pointed out that we, in our little world, have a similar type of experience. That is on an essential level rather than a functional level. One thing that I mentioned recently, that if you see a home that is very fully appointed like a lived-in home, and it looks like it was lived in, and you become very enthused by it. Oh, what life transpired in this home? Who lived here? Etc. It's all very enticing. And then you find out that nobody ever lived in this home. It was never meant to live in. It was set up by an artist to approximate what a lived-in home looks like. Once you find out this piece of information, you're completely turned off. You lose interest in visiting this home. This is not a home. Although, there is no way to explain the difference between what you observed prior to finding out this point and now. It's exactly the same thing. Except prior to that, you related to the etzem, to the reality behind what you were looking. And now you know that there is no reality. And how does that change anything? Doesn't change it. But because you are a human being, because you have this insight of a true nature, to you it makes a difference. It doesn't make a difference to the observing eye, to make a difference at all, to anything below the human intellect. And even the human intellect, if he so prefers, he can become an idiotic Calvinist, and he will lose that also.